From just outside our nation's capital, from Abiding Life Grace and Faith Church in Northern Virginia, thank you for joining me for another edition of Rivers of Living Water. I'm Ken Miller. For more information about this ministry, go online to abidinglife.net or ROLW.org. Feel free to send me an email, pastor@abidinglife.net. Our mailing address is Post Office Box 772, Annandale, Virginia. Our meeting location is 45449 East 7 Way, Sterling, Virginia. Sunday mornings, 11 o'clock.
The whole subject of rest, resting in Him, and the whole concept of rest has transformed my way of thinking about Christianity in general, what it means to be a Christian, and that type of thing. It all started really with, all through my adult life after graduating from Richmond, even while I was at Richmond, there was some other Richmond graduate. I didn't know him, but he died. Like in the 40s, and as years went by, I knew of other, not just Raymond Gregor, but other people who were well established in the Word of Faith, dying prematurely, or by prematurely, I mean, during the 40s and 50s. Even the 50s, 60s, I would say, even for me, even in the 50s and 70s, would be prematurely, so I wouldn't make a big deal about this. But when they died in their 30s and 40s and 50s, I know something's not right. There's always somebody who says, well, believe it or not, some people would have to say, well, it must have been their time, or one person actually said, well, one time, God must have needed them back down, or something like that. As if God needs them here to be in heaven with Him. But His love for us, He was with us always, but it always bothered me that we know the promises of God, we preach the promises of God, but when they don't seem to work for us, What is going on? What is the problem? If something isn't working, King Hagin would say, well, the hidden things belong to God. And that satisfied me for a while. It probably would have satisfied me. But it just happened rarely. This seemed to happen every year. I would hear another great Word of Faith person who died prematurely. So it really bothered me for a long time. And I think I wasn't satisfied with anything until I really grabbed hold of the message of rest. So it seems to be like the reason why faith doesn't work for so many faith people is because they're trying to get their faith to work for them. That's what I'm saying. They take the faith principles and they don't make them, they make them into work. Like when I say faith comes by hearing and hearing, I don't see that as a work. I need to put in my 2 hours of scripture every day in order to get my faith to grow, or I have to spend my 30 minutes speaking in tongues in order to get my faith to grow. You know, when we take the faith principles and we turn them into work, I think that we're defeating our purpose. But when we learn to just simply grace in the promises of God, in my conclusion is, how did we get saved? Most of us, anyway, believe that we're saved by grace, right? I mean, I know there's still some people who believe that salvation by works, but that's probably a lot of people. But we've taught for years that you're saved by grace through faith. It doesn't matter in the morning whether you feel safe or not. You rest in the fact that God saved your faith when you're saved. So I think I come to the conclusion, and this has worked for me. It doesn't matter how I feel. God's word says I feel, so that's good enough for me. I don't go by my feelings. I rest in His promises. Okay? And that's coming from someone who had a mild heart attack. I think I was 40 or 41. I don't even remember how old I was at the time. But I, as I said before, throughout my 40s, I had a lot of health issues. But once I grabbed a hold of the message of grace, not just grace, but I believe I've always been a great teacher. When I grabbed a hold of the message of rest, which is because of grace, when I began to realize that all I need to do is just rest in your promises and truly trust, you know, the definition for trust in the dictionary is the mind at rest. So if we're anxious about the promises of God, if we show any anxiety about our situation, no matter what it is we're going through, such a rest. I was asked once, or I was told once, I just can't rest, except by something you seem to be concerned about. I was told, or maybe it was in the form of a question, how can I rest? When I have so much things in my place to make me so that I can care, bills for the food, and bills for that, so many things going on. How can I rest? And I'm sure that I've got some very tangible things from the scripture. But then again, we could turn that into a work of faith, step one, step two, step three. I'm not a rest, that's not my intent. But there are some clear scriptural principles on how to enter into this rest. But today, I primarily want to focus in on Hebrews 3 and 4, primarily 4, but there's a lot right here in the book of Hebrews about rest. We've always emphasized things without works of faith, without belief in Jesus. Faith without corresponding action of faith. So sometimes we have the understanding that we have to put some kind of action to prove that we're in faith. But I think the greatest faith action is just simply to rest. Rest in His work, and faith without His work. He really did all the work that needs to be done. Okay, so all we need to do is rest in His work. And if you're truly walking in faith, it should be evident. It should be evident in your attitude towards your situation. You should be in a position of rest. You should be in a position of shalom peace. So we don't think of rest as being an answer, but I would say that Buckner's advice very interesting, like you mentioned. But faith is demonstrated through rest. Rest is a faith action. When we get to the book of Hebrews, I just think years ago I really didn't understand Hebrews that well, but I've come to understand the book of Hebrews today, just like all the Bible is pointing at Jesus. It's really showing that Hebrew scriptures who were still thinking they had to demonstrate works and rituals to please God. The writer to the book of Hebrews is just simply saying that Jesus is the fulfillment of all of that. We don't need to go through all those rituals anymore because Jesus is the fulfillment. In chapter 1, of Hebrews, it reveals that Jesus Christ is greater than the prophets, and He's greater than the angels. In chapter 2, it reveals that Jesus is greater than mankind, even though He became a man. He became one of us. And then at the beginning of chapter 3, He talks about how Jesus is greater than Moses, though He is the fulfillment of everything Moses said and did. And then later on, I think it's in chapter, right around chapter 9, where he starts talking about the different articles of furniture in the tabernacle and how they all point to Jesus. Jesus is the fulfillment of everything in the tabernacle, of the tabernacle itself. But, and then he also talks about Melchizedek and tithing and that type of thing, where Jesus is the fulfillment of the priesthood. He is the great high priest. I think it's in chapter 5 where he talks about the priesthood and Aaron and that Jesus is the greater high priest. From chapter 3, verse 11, through chapter 4, verse 11, it seems to be talking about rest. That it reveals Jesus is upon the greater Sabbath. He is our place of rest. Our rest is a sound in the day of the week. Our rest is a sound in any ritual that we need to perform, but our rest is found in the work of Jesus Christ on the cross. So, when we get to chapter 3, verse 1, I want to give a few verses to introduce where this is going. First of all, in this verse 1, it shares with us the idea of fixing your thoughts on Jesus. Fix your thoughts on Jesus, which might remind you of chapter 12, where it talks about looking at the Jesus, where one translation says, fix your focus on Jesus. And to me, this is the solution to every problem. Just stay focused on Jesus. Don't be focused on your problem. Focus on Jesus. And if you're focused on Jesus and rest in what He did on the cross, He will take care of you no matter what it is you're going through. And this is important, I believe, in the very next verse. It says, Jesus is, well, this depends on what translation you're looking at. This is a bad word translation, but some translations say Jesus was, but I think more accurately, Jesus is faithful to God who appointed Him. In the same way that Moses was faithful when he served in God's house. He says the same thing in verses 4, verses 5 through 6. Now Moses was faithful in all God's house as a servant to testify to the things that were to be spoken later. But Christ is present and faithful over God now as the Son. Okay, so for Moses, he was, Jesus is. But Moses was a servant. Jesus is the Son. And we are his God. Notice it says that up until 3:6. Jesus is faithful in his house. Jesus is the faithful Son in his Father's house. But what is his house? We are his house. Paul makes that point in 2 Corinthians also, that we are the temple of God. We are his house. So, Christ, God, he dwells within us, but he is faithful within his house. Praise God. Skipping down to verses 10 through 12. Therefore, I was angry with that generation and said, they always go astray in their hearts. And he's referring to the children of Israel going through, being led by Moses through the wilderness from Egypt to the promised land. He says he was angry with them. Why was he angry with them? He says they have not known my ways. They have not known my ways. Well, what are the ways of God? God is a God of grace. God is a God of faith. God is a God of love. But they didn't receive God in that name. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Now that statement is repeated several times. They shall not enter my rest. Beware, brethren, lest there be any in any of you and people of heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. I want you to see in the full context of talking about rest, the different use of the rest. There's an emphasis on belief, and unbelief is faith. Believing that God means what he says and trusting him, fully trusting him, that helps us to enter into his rest. This is the key element. Okay, verses 16 through 19, I did this in the English Standard Version. For who were those who heard and yet rebelled? Was it not those who left Egypt, led by Moses? And with whom was he provoked for 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose bodies fell in the wilderness? What is this thing he's talking about? I'll talk about that in just a second. And to whom did he swear that he would not enter, that they would not enter his rest, but those who were disobedient? Well, how did they sin and how were they disobedient? Well, I think he answered that in his last statement. So we see that they were unable to enter because of unbelief. So the sin they committed, that they have been demonstrated in all kinds of examples, but the core sin was unbelief. The core disobedience was unbelief. They did not fully trust God. They did not fully believe God. They wanted to trust their own works and their own behavior, their own actions, instead of trusting God. So, having said all that, let's get into chapter 4, verse 1. Therefore, let us fear. Let us therefore fear. Lest the promise being left off of entering into his rest. And again, he's still talking about entering into the rest. The whole concept here is entering into his rest, which is what I call the Christian Sabbath, the true Christian Sabbath. Churches want to argue whether it's Saturday or Sunday or whatever, but the true Christian Sabbath is Jesus. He is the Christian Sabbath. We find our rest in him. So he says, let us therefore fear that the promise being left off of entering into his rest, any of you who seem to come short of it. So what is he talking about? He's being regularly told, fear not, or be not anxious about anything. But the book of Hebrews, the writer to Hebrews, is telling us there is one thing you should fear. What is the one thing he says you should fear? Fear that you don't enter his rest. Fear lest the promise being left us of entering into his rest. He used to speak to Paul Jordan. So this isn't talking about heaven. I've read some commentaries that this is talking about heaven. This isn't talking about heaven. I actually even saw one guy on YouTube said that he's talking about the seventh day Sabbath. No, he's not talking about a Sabbath day either. But he's talking about living in a state of faith, true faith. Not a faith based upon works, but a faith based upon resting in his promises. Resting in the fact that when Jesus said it is finished, he meant it is finished. Whatever it is that you're battling in this life, you can rest in the fact that Jesus said it's finished. Therefore, it is finished. God wants us to live in a state of spiritual rest. Like, I know I've mentioned this scripture, I think, regularly the past few weeks, Deuteronomy 6, where it tells us that God told Israel that he would bring them to the cities that they didn't build. God told them that they could drink from wells that they didn't build and meditations that they didn't plant. God told them that he wanted them to enjoy everything that he had created and enjoy it in abundance. Not just a little, but he said, even till you're full. You know, God is a gracious God. God is a generous God. He's a God of abundance, and he wants us to be effortless on our part because he did all the effort. He did all the work. Because he wants us to be in a continual state of resting in him. He wants us to simply enjoy the work that he has done for us. He did all the work. So what's our part is simply to rest and to rest. He did all the work. We need to rest in what he accomplished. And we need to do this with all of our heart and with all of our soul and just simply going to rest in it and rest in it and believe that he paid the price, that he paid the price in full, and he's always given to you all of this and more. So going back to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 2, for unto us was the gospel preached, as well as to them. Now I find it interesting that the gospel was preached to the children of Israel, going through the wilderness. And if we truly understand all the types and shadows of the furniture and everything else, even the shape of the encampment was in the shape of the promise. You know, there was a certain travel on the side, and if you had an aerial view of it, it would probably look like a promise. But so much about everything about the encampment, the tabernacle, each particle of furniture in the tabernacle, it all points to Jesus' work. Getting to talk about all of this sometimes seems to get nothing else to go on with the easy. Because eventually we'll be going to the book of Exodus. And we'll die and we'll get into all of that, especially on Wednesday. But I'll probably do some sermon from Sunday morning. Because that's what all those lines do. That every piece of furniture pointed to Jesus. Jesus is the fulfillment of everything. So the writer to the Hebrews is saying the gospel is preached to us, but it's also preached to them. But it did not profit them, not being mixed with faith. And then the third, so again, we get back to the idea of faith. You have to believe it. It's not going to work in you. Nothing that Jesus accomplished on the cross can be realized in your life unless you believe it. You're not going to demonstrate that you believe it. Rest. You know, you don't have to do something to prove that you believe it. Just rest in what he just said. All right. Verse 3. For we which have believed, the word for the king that I said, we which have faith, can enter into rest. This is so awesome. Just simply believe it. That's all you have to do. Just trace the inference. Just simply believe it. Although the works were finished from the foundations of the world. I find that statement interesting too because there's a scripture that says Jesus was crucified. Where did Jesus finish the work? When he was crucified. But there's a scripture that says he was crucified from the foundations of the world. Don't ask me to explain that. God created time. So whatever that means, it was all finished before it even started from the foundations of the world. We know that all the way back to Genesis 2, the scripture says that God rested from all his work. He rested from all his work in Genesis chapter 2. So everything was completed. Everything was finished at that point. Verse 4. For he spent in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, God did rest the seventh day from all his work. But then what I just said, quote what it said in Genesis chapter 2, that he rested from all his work. So we just simply need to believe that what God said is true. We need to believe that Jesus accomplished what he said accomplished on the cross. And what he accomplished on the cross was for you. Not just for everybody else, you know, individually for you. What Jesus did on the cross was for you. And if we don't rest in the finished work of the cross, we will not see the manifestation of it in our lives. And it's natural to think that unless I do something, nothing will get done. But he's coming up to rest in him. And he will finish, he has finished the work and we need to be resting in him to see it manifested in our lives. Praise God. So believe that he finished the work and he's working it in him and he's working it for you. Believe that he is bringing it into the fullness of the manifestation, and he is bringing you into the fullness of the image of Jesus Christ. At the end, in this passage, he said, let's come out into my rest, verse 5, verse 6. see therefore his remaining, the Son of God entered therein, and those to whom they were first preached entered not because of unbelief. This principle is written, re-emphasized over and over again, the fact that under the Old Covenant, they did not enter God's rest because of unbelief. It wasn't because of any performance of sending or ceremony or anything like that. It was unbelief. That is why they didn't enter into God's rest again. In Leviticus 13, verse 7, David, today, after so long a time, as it is said today, the people hear his voice, pardon not their hearts. So this is quoting, he's quoting here from Psalm 95, where David, reflecting back to 500 years later, the children of Israel went through the word, this is about 500 years later, and David is saying at that point, after so long a time, today, if you will hear his voice and pardon not your heart, you can enter into that grace. That's what Psalm 95 is talking about. We can go into that sometime in the future too, but it's talking about these things for the grace. David is talking about the same thing in his day. For if Jesus had given them rest, now this Jesus is not Jesus Christ. In fact, King James Version is the only translation that I found that translates this Jesus. Pretty much all other translations translate with Joshua. And it's the same Hebrew word as Yeshua, whether it's Jesus or Joshua, it's still Yeshua. So if Joshua had given them rest, in other words, if Joshua, if entering into the land of Canaan was the rest that God was talking about, then why would it have said afterward, why would it have spoken of another day of rest? Okay, so in his point here, I believe it's just simply that, yes, they did finally enter into the promised land, but that wasn't really what God was talking about. He wasn't talking about that place as being the place of rest. He's talking about faith in him and a place of rest. Rest is a place where you know that God has got you in his hands. Rest, the rest we're talking about is when you know that you're secure in his arms, that he's got your back, that he's taking care of you, and you can rest in his promises. You can stop trying to figure out, well, why isn't this working here? What work do I need to do to make my faith work for me? But just simply rest. Rest is what the earth is for the first time. For there remains, therefore, a rest for the people of God. There is a rest. For he says, if he's entered into his rest, he also has peace from his own works, as God did for his. If you're struggling, trying to make your faith work for you, you have entered into the rest that he's talking about. But when you're resting in him, when you're truly trusting him, when you're not trying to make your faith work for you, but you're not struggling to try to make things work, but you're just simply resting in him. The question I want to ask you this morning is, do you want to work, struggle, and put effort into becoming a better Christian? Or do you just simply want to rest and be blessed? And I believe that's what it's talking about, is effortlessly blessed, effortless change. It's effortless. It should be effortless. We shouldn't be having to strive to make this thing work. We should be just resting in him. But the thing that stopped the children of Israel repeatedly, it mentioned several times in these verses that we looked at, it was their unbelief. It was their unbelief. But unbelief stops the power of God from flowing. Unbelief stops your ability to rest in him. Unbelief stops your ability to rest in his promises. When I fully rest in him, when I fully rest in his finished work, I have access to all the blessings that he has. So, if we're going to labor at anything, let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest. If you want to put your effort into doing something, put your effort into resting. All right? Let any man fall after the same example of a three-man that he gave me. He's re-emphasizing one more time that it's unbelief that hinders people from walking in the promises of God. It's unbelief that hinders people from resting in him. Ask yourself, am I in the Sabbath rest of God? And I would say that no matter what befalls me today or tomorrow or at any time of my life, I am resting in the promises of God. I'm resting in his arms. I know he's got my back. I know that no matter what happens throughout the week, that God will work all things for good, even if I make mistakes. Romans 8:28, all things work together for good. All things work together for good to those who love Him, who are called according to His purpose. But He will take even your mistakes and turn them into a blessing. We're not trying to be fully accepted. We can rest in the fact that we already are accepted. He has made us accepted. So therefore, let us labor.
How do you explain? How do you describe a love that goes from east to west and runs as deep as it is wide? You know all our hopes, Lord, you know all our spirits sing, a song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. We will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. Words are not enough to tell you of our love, so listen to our heart. Could fall like rain from these lips of mine, and if I had a thousand years, I would still run out of time. But if you listen to our hearts, every beat would say, thank you for the life, thank you for the truth. Thank you for the way. So listen to our hearts. Hear our spirits sing. The song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. We will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. The words are not enough to tell you of our love, so listen to our hearts. If words could fall like rain, if words could fall like rain from these lips of mine, and if I had a thousand years, I would still run out of time. So if you listen to our heart, every beat will say, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. So listen to our hearts, hear our spirits sing, the song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. We will use the words we know to tell you what it is. Listen to our hearts, hear our spirits sing, the song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. We will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. Words are not enough to tell you of our love. Words are not enough to tell you of our love, so listen to our hearts. From just outside our nation's capital, from Abiding Life Grace and Faith Church in Northern Virginia, thank you for joining me for another edition of Rivers of Living Water. I'm Ken Miller. For more information about this ministry, go online to abidinglife.net or ROLW.org. Feel free to send me an email, pastor@abidinglife.net. Our mailing address is Post Office Box 772, Annandale, Virginia. Our meeting location is 45449 East Severn Way, Sterling, Virginia, Sunday mornings 11 o'clock.
This does not imply us now going, sitting on a chair or going and sitting in a park and doing nothing for the rest of our life. Okay? Really important to get that. And I'm going to elaborate on that a little bit further on as we go this morning. So, what is God's plan for us? The Amplified, or in South Africa we call it the Electric Bible. In Jeremiah 29, verse 11 says, "For I know the thoughts and the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Thoughts and plans for welfare, for peace, not for evil, to give you hope in your final outcome." So let's just extract a few things from the scripture. So firstly, we see that God has a plan for welfare. He wants it to be well with us in all aspects of our life. God wants us to experience inner peace. God does not want us to have evil in us. That's not in His plan for us. God wants us to have hope. And God wants a bright future for all of us. So, in order to understand the plan of God, let's have a closer look. We could never fully comprehend God, but let's have a look at the character of God, at what God chooses to reveal to us. Well, firstly, we see that God is self-sustainable. God does not need man for anything. He certainly does not need 10% of my finances to do what He knows He already has done and can do and will do. The Hebrew word, in Genesis 1 verse 1, it says, "In the beginning, God," that God translated to the Hebrew, is Elohim. And Elohim, translated from the Hebrew, means the putter forth of power. That means that all power originates from God, because God is power. And because God is power, the source of all energy, He needs nothing. He is energy and power. So let's look at this in a more practical way. Let's try and understand this power, awesome power of God, this greatness of God. Let's try and understand this from a human point of view. Well, Scripture tells us that the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5:22, the fruit of God's Spirit is love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness. We've all heard these, but I want to speak them out. I'm speaking them out over you. In the spiritual realm, something is just happening here this morning. goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. This is the substance of God. Love, joy, peace. Man, these are good things. Yeah. So I want to ask a question here this morning. Is there anyone here who by his own efforts, by his own self, is full and perfect in love? Come on now. When I look at the world, man, I don't see this. Is there anyone here this morning that is perfect and just full of peace? I don't see that. Not in this world. Patience, kindness, goodness. Do you see? God knew the man of heart, and that the heart of man was wicked above all things. And that's why God knew he had to come and plant a new seed, an indestructible seed into our hearts. And that's the seed of love, the fruit of the Spirit in that seed. And here's the thing, folks. Many people, when taught about the fruit of the Spirit, they don't quite understand the fruit of the Spirit because they don't understand the heart of God in this. God wants us to grow spiritually, mentally, to prosper as we are, as He created us. And fruit, if you go and plant a little seed in the ground, does that seed immediately bring apples and pears? And no. And this is a concept that few churches really understand right, because they don't understand the grace of God correctly. Fruit takes a time. There's a period. You plant that seed and you keep on watering that seed, and sometimes you just go and loosen up that soil just a little bit to give those roots, those young roots, chance to grow. And then you just, at the right time, give it just the right amount of water. And you've got to watch that seed. You've got to be mindful of what you're doing. And likewise, in our spiritual lives, in our emotional lives, in our souls, we've got to do the same thing. I'm going to get into that a little bit later on this morning. So, I want to ask another question. Is there anyone here? And if I go at this pace, Pastor Ken knows. Man, poor guys on Wednesday evenings. So, I want to ask a question. Is there anyone here present this morning that says, no thanks, I don't want the fruit of the Spirit. I don't need it. I wonder if we asked the entire world, I wonder if we asked ISIS, if we sat down and spoke to them one-on-one, gracefully, if we went and sat down and spoke to them as people, because we have the love of God in us, the grace of God in us, we understand, if they would still be beheading people. You see, it's religion that causes wars. It's not God. No, it's man that causes wars. So, let's have a look at God's heart for man. God's heart for man is for all people to be at peace. All people. And it's when we are at peace within ourselves that we then enter into His rest. So from a biblical point of view, without God's peace, I cannot enter into rest. Because if I try and enter into rest, well, do I have perfect love? perfect joy. And so we can go on. Are you getting God's heart this morning for you? You see, God knew that it was impossible for man to find peace and enter into his rest by man's works and efforts alone. And this is why in my counseling, God has shown me that I'm to help folks get self-aware, get to a state of self-awareness, and then take them and lay them at the feet of God. And he does the healing. He's the healer. So, it was through grace, what God made possible for man to enter into his rest. Now, let's just have a quick look at grace. And for those who've seen my sermons, you're just going to get this over and over. So, grace basically means to extend goodness, kindness, mercy to someone without them having earned it or deserving it. Do I hear an ISIS in brackets there, or whoever? Our worst enemies. Just get this. To extend goodness, kindness, mercy without someone having someone earned it or deserve it, even whilst being opposed. So you're giving all of this and they're saying, no thanks, buddy, I don't want that, I don't need that. This is what Jesus Christ did on the cross for us. And I just, in my spirit, I get moved every time I say this. Because he understood that we didn't, Jesus understood that we don't understand his heart. And because we don't understand his heart, he knew that he would help us through grace. It's when we're condemning folks, especially in church, when we're condemning folks outside of church, they look at us and they say, come on, I don't want part of that. Are you nuts? Come on now. Amen. Yeah. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15 says, exercise foresight and be on the watch. And again, this is from the Amplified Bible. Exercise foresight and be on the watch to look after one another. Come on now. What's that? To look after myself alone? Amen. God's saying, see to it that no one falls back from and fails to secure God's grace. Come on. See to it that no one fails to secure God's grace. Why does God say here, look at one another? In other words, have one another's back. You see, the moment I am not graceful towards people, I'm not helping them to receive God's grace, which is free. I'm not helping them to see the grace of God inside of me and working through me and in me. Amen. And it goes on to say, in order that no root of resentment, bitterness, or hatred shoots forth. Folks, this is why I counsel so many folks every week. People are not securing God's grace because they're holding on to the root of bitterness and angerness, of hatred, things that happened in their lives. Scripture says, I mean, look at how wise God is, how God is counseling us here from Scripture. Of hatred, things that happened in their lives. Scripture says, I mean, look at how wise God is, how God is counseling us here from Scripture. I'm just going to read this again. To see that no one falls back from and fails to secure God's grace, in order that no root of resentment, bitterness, or hatred shoots forth and causes trouble and bitter torment. I'm yet to speak to any person that God uses me to counsel with, who do not feel in their heart tormented by all these heavy soul issues. Because of bitterness and hatred, people fail to secure God's enabling ability, because that's the other meaning of grace, is it's a gift of enabling ability. So how's God enabling us? Through His Spirit, the fruit of His Spirit. And we're gonna get to the how a little bit later on this morning. What's very important here, folks, and this is what mainstream churches teach and preach, is they want to teach us how we can get grace. Well, thank you, Lord Jesus, that at Abiding Life we believe that grace is available and sufficient to all, not to just an elect, not just to these couple of folks here. You don't have to do anything to earn grace. Amen. Because God has done it. When He said, "It is finished," He said, "It's finished." Therefore, you need not walk around this morning with condemnation. You do not need to walk around with the past. Amen. St. John 15 verse 5 says, God says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I abideth in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. Without me, you can do nothing." What are we hearing here? Can we do anything without God? But I do not believe in behavioral psychology. I used to do that stuff. Until God showed me, what you're doing is you're helping folks to manage their emotions. They're not getting healed. And I sat back because I hadn't been healed. And only when I experienced the healing hand of God, man, I was set free. And I could then start ministering transparently about God's hand in me. Not about some mumbo jumbo that I learned about psychology. Amen. So, I want to just bless you, my boy. I just want to share with you what I call the garden concept. In the garden concept, God is the park's manager, if you want to look at it that way. And we are the gardeners. And God has given each and every one of us a garden to tend to. Okay? So in Scripture, God uses words, and we're going to see just now, God uses words like soil, seed, root, fruit, vine, branches, water, and I can go on. Man, this list just can go on. So I want to ask you this morning, has anyone here stood in a beautiful garden? Come on, let me see hands. Anyone? Everyone? Yeah? Okay. So if I asked you, without looking at the slide now, don't cheat now. God's watching you. Yes, Lord. So I want to ask you, what's the feeling that you experienced when you stood in that beautiful, cared for garden? When you looked at it and you saw, wow, this is perfection. Come on, just shout out a few. What did you feel? Please, come on, guys, help me. Beauty. Okay? What did you feel about beauty? What did you feel in your heart? Sorry, Pastor Ken? Amen. 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 Okay. This is the heart of God. When I'm sitting and I'm looking at my garden, and I look at my garden through what Jesus Christ did for me, man, I cannot but stand in my garden in awe of beauty. So, What is the feeling that you, on the other side, that you have when you look at a garden, when you walk into a garden and you see, man, this, it's been neglected. There's so much potential here, but no effort has gone into this garden. There's so much seed that's been planted, but no effort. After planting a seed and watering it over time, if you took time to nurture that little seed, and eventually one morning you wake up, come on now, I want to challenge you. Everyone's challenging with a water bucket. I want to challenge you with a Christian seed challenge this morning. Go and get seed. And instead of, come on guys, this is a challenge for the guys this morning. Instead of you going and buying your lady a beautiful flower, go and buy a seed. And you tell her, sweetheart, you see the seed? I'm dropping it into the soil for you. And then you start nurturing that seed prayerfully. Man, what God's going to do in your relationship with your lady, the first morning when you wake up and there's a little greenness there, man, that's life. Because you've put in a lot of effort into that. Come on now, boys. I want to see that. I want photos. And I want to post them on Facebook, okay? Amen. So, can you imagine your lady's face? If you brought her that flower and you said, this is for you, honey, and she knows what you put into that. Come on now.
I am Ken Miller, and I'd like to tell you about Rivers of Living Water. The program features uplifting sermons of abundant grace, unwavering faith, the Spirit-led life, the finished work of the cross of Jesus, and the radical love of our Heavenly Father. You can get more information about this ministry at rolw.org or abidinglife.net. Feel free to contact me, Ken, at rolw.org or pastor at abidinglife.net.
Pumpkin, I eat it till I just coming out my ears. I eat it till I hate it. And then they take a break, and then next year I do it again. Amen. But I post first pumpkin spice latte of the year. Hashtag awesome. I do. I am that guy. Hallelujah. My friends call me a basic white girl. That's funny to some of you. Some of y'all just think that's weird, but got my leggings. No, I'm just kidding. Forgive me. Yes. Easy now. Say man bun. No, it's probably not. It's probably low. It's funny because I can't man bun my own hair. My wife's got to man bun me. Because I'm getting better. Because I FaceTime her. I say, honey, is that right? Now, when I was first doing it, I really could not do it at all. Like, it was really fr- I, like, break a sweat trying to get a man bun on. I'm, like, pulling a muscle and, like, going down for the count, getting some Bengay. I don't want to try again. Just kidding. Just kidding. I'm not even real sure why I said that. Pumpkin spice latte. Hashtag awesome. And then people would, like, Facebook me and be like, you're drinking the coffee of idols, you know? And man, I'd get mad. And I'd be like, y'all ever Facebook like that or social media like, and then be like cutting and pasting scriptures, you know, say Corinthians where I, you know, meat offered to idols and all that. And praise the Lord. And I'm better now. I don't deal with it. I handle it better than I used to. Because usually I'd want to argue with them. Yeah, that's it. It's fabulous. It's called unfollow. No, I don't know. I have to be careful with that too. Because how many know they need ministry too? Praise God. But it's easier just to do that. But my point being with that, how many know to them, they shouldn't drink Starbucks coffee. It's wrong for them to do that. And you know what? Out of a place of love, I should have a place of respect for that. I didn't say I did. I'm working on some stuff, you know. But I have the liberty, because my comment one time was, I'll drink coffee offered to idols. I have no problem with it. And if you don't want yours, I'll drink yours too. I feel the same way about Halloween candy, amen? We spent years and years not celebrating Halloween. Now we celebrate Halloween. I'll eat all the candy offered to idols. And that may bother somebody, and if it does, I'm sorry. But, you know, amen. But at the same time, how many know my liberty? I have to be careful with it. You know what will steward my liberty properly? Love. Amen. And so God wants us to enjoy this liberty, but at the same time, how many, there's certain things I probably shouldn't do or say around certain people. You know, I go into some pretty, you know, denominational church. I preached at a Church of God not too long ago, and yeah, it was awesome. Everybody thought I was going to get saved. They're like, yes, this guy's in here. He's going to get saved. Oh, dear God, he's the special speaker. Let's leave, you know. It happens often. I always sit in the back. You know, it's funny. But when I go in there, I mean, I don't need to go in there and preach what I'm preaching here tonight. I need to take them by the hand and love them where they're at and take them just as far as they're ready to go. Because why? Because if, I mean, I'm not there to perform for them. I'm not there to show them all the stuff I know. I'm there to love them and to help them. And so the love of God will steward the liberty in a place of honor. And as this reformation is taking place, we're learning how to enjoy this liberty and also learning how to steward it properly. And the only thing that does that is the love of God to us and through us. Amen? Awesome. Thank you, guys. Praise God.
From just outside our nation's capital, from Abiding Life Grace and Faith Church in Northern Virginia, thank you for joining me for another edition of Rivers of Living Water. I'm Ken Miller. For more information about this ministry, go online to abidinglife.net or rolw.org. Feel free to send me an email, pastor@abidinglife.net. Our mailing address is Post Office Box 772, Annandale, Virginia. Our meeting location is 45449 East Severn Way, Sterling, Virginia, Sunday mornings 11 o'clock.